Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by Cashfly at CACHEFLY.com.
Hi, this is Leo Laporte, and once again, time for Twit's audience survey. We'd really like to hear from you. It's only going to take a couple of minutes, really. That's all. Just go to twit.tv/survey and let us know what you think. Your anonymous feedback will help us make Twit even better. And thanks for your continued support.
This is Triangulation, episode 287, recorded Monday, February 27th, 2017. John Markoff. Triangulation is brought to you by Betterment, a smart, easy-to-use, and less expensive way to invest for your financial future. Get 1 month managed free when you make an initial deposit of $10,000 or more at betterment.com/triangulation. And by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at quickenloans.com/triangulation. And by Blue Apron, the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. See what's on the menu this week and get 3 meals free with your first purchase with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/triangulation. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get together with some of the most interesting people in technology and talk about, you know, well, the sky's the limit. Whatever's on their mind, their history, their story, what they see happening in the world around us. We've got a perfect person for that today. John Markoff is my guest. John, for many years, worked at the New York Times, reported on technology. There was really their senior technology guy, has written many, many books. Including, I guess, the most recent one is the Loving Machines one.
Machines of Loving Grace.
I love that name. Welcome, John Markoff, to Triangulation. It's great to see you again.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
John has appeared on Twit in the olden days, and we worked together. I think even on the radio show with John C. Dvorak. So, I think
you go back a long way.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. What is the Machines of Loving Grace? That sounds familiar. The name.
The title comes from a poem written by Richard Brautigan.
Oh yes.
In the early 60s, and it's very evocative. I mean, if you listen, the poem is worth reading. If I could have chosen the title, I might have had a question mark after "Machines of Love and Grace," but that's not the way it worked out.
Because it's about artificial intelligence, the future of smart machines, and whether they're going to eat us alive.
Right, although, you know, I really don't go down the eat us alive path. Great science fiction. I love science fiction, but probably we can deal with autonomy without sentience.
That Machines of Loving Grace does kind of imply, well, I mean, you can't have grace without sentience, right? And you can't love without sentience.
Yeah, and then, you know, if you sort of break down the current crop of science fiction movies, there is the Ex Machina ending, but I actually am much more of a fan of a movie called Her, which was about conversational systems. And, you know, it also posits the singularity and super intelligent machines. And it turns out that in Her, after they become super intelligent, they're kind of bored with us and they go off and do something interesting, which is much more plausible.
It is a really wonderful ending, isn't it? Her, who is the voice of Scarlett Johansson, and of course, Joaquin Phoenix falls in love with her. We can give you a spoiler now. It's several years old. I don't know what the statute of limitations is on these. But he falls in love with her. She kind of acts like, you know, cute and flirty, but eventually gets bored, and all the machines get together. And she says, "We'll see. We got our own thing going on."
Yeah.
But it's reasonable for humans to fear that a little bit, because what is that own thing? And what is our role in that? Are we just going to be cockroaches, you know, in the planet now?
Yeah, well, so it's going to take a while to get to self-aware systems. The machines are becoming more autonomous, and that's impressive. But self-awareness, I think no one knows how to get there yet. And I bet you it doesn't happen in our lifetime.
Yeah, thank God. Of course, we're old, John.
Yeah, so it might not be that long.
It might be our kids' lifetime. Who knows? Or our grandkids' lifetime. You started the New York Times in 1988.
That's true.
Wow.
I did.
Tell me how that happened.
Well, it's a funny story. I credit my job at the New York Times in part to my former wife, Katie Hafner, who wrote books with me in the past. But Katie was at Business Week, and the New York Times had to replace a reporter who was moving to Japan, David Sanger. And so they looked around, and Andy Pollack, who was the Times bureau chief in San Francisco at that time, suggested that they approach Katie, who was the at that time the Silicon Valley reporter for Business Week. I was at the Examiner, and Katie, excuse me,
the legendary Examiner with was Will Hurst running it when you were there?
He was. Yeah. Will hired me, in effect. Yeah.
Yeah. Will, of course, the grandson of William Randolph Hearst. Is also a massive geek. And in fact, for many years, he and John C. Dvorak threw the party to be at Comdex.
That's right. It was a wonderful party. And it was also a little bit intimidating to work for a publisher who knew more about C compilers than you did.
Yeah, Will's a mathematician. Will's actually kind of a brilliant mathematician. But this was not your first tech job. You were at Byte and InfoWorld before that, as I remember, right?
That's right. Yeah. My first actually real job was at InfoWorld. I was part of the wave of people who came in when Pat McGovern bought Intelligent Machines Journal from Jim Warren and turned it into InfoWorld, a weekly publication.
Jim Warren. There's another wonderful name, the creator of the West Coast Computer
way
Fair
back.
With an E at the end. But those were kind of magical times in the Bay Area. I know your current project is about Stewart Brand, who created the Whole Earth catalog. And then later, the Whole Earth Electronic Link.
And that's right. But remember, he also created the Hackers Conference with Kevin Kelly in 1985, which sort of led to the open source software world.
Wow. It's really, I think those times are so interesting. You point out that almost everybody from those times, you know, we're counterculture. It came out of the 60s, the counterculture 60s.
Well, that was one of the threads. I mean, I've always said that Silicon Valley didn't have a single culture, but it's a very diverse place, and there's lots of different things going on. And there was, and it's also more or less innovative at different times. And one of the periods where a lot of innovation went on was in that period, sort of 65 to 75, which was the prehistory of personal computing. That period, and much of that stuff happened right around Stanford. At the same time that there was a counterculture emerging in the mid-60s and the anti-war movement was going on, it was a wonderful time, a crazy time to be around Silicon Valley. Actually, it was before it was Silicon Valley. It didn't get named Silicon Valley until 1971.
Yeah. That's about when you graduated from college, 71.
It is exactly when I graduated from college.
So you're entering this very interesting world. Were you always interested in tech? I mean, was that something you did as
I sort of had bounced around. No, I didn't really get drawn into it until I came back from... I dropped out of graduate school in 77 and came back to the Valley. And the personal computer industry is around, but I was actually still deeply wound up in the anti-war movement. And I was writing about defense companies. And then in 1980, Ronald Reagan was elected. There was a dark side of the force and a light side of the force. And it was just more fun to write about these little hobbyist machines and this hobbyist culture that was all around me on the peninsula.
Yeah. Yeah. I think about Katie's book. Did you work on Where Wizards Stay Up Late?
That was her book. That was her book.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. But what books did you two work on?
Well, we wrote a book called Cyberpunk about three kids who got in trouble for breaking into computer networks.
That's right. And then, of course, the book, What the Dormouse...
There was What the Dormouse Said, How the 60 Counterculture Shaped the Personal Computer Industry. And then after that, there was a book called Takedown, written with Satomo Shimomura.
Yeah. Yeah. Kevin Mitnick story, which Kevin has always been very bitter about for some reason. I'm not sure what that story
Kevin has been bitter about it, but, you know, who would have known him if it wasn't for that?
Yeah, he should thank you.
Where's my 10%?
He always liked, so Jonathan Lippman wrote a book at the same time, and he always liked Lippman's book better than your book. I stayed well away from that, knowing all the parties involved. I just didn't want to get involved.
It was very complicated. There were three books, actually, and one really bad movie, if anybody cares
That movie, I forgot, yeah. Yeah, well, everybody's still around, still working, so that's good. Nobody was harmed in all of that. So what was it about technology that made you want to go to InfoWorld? Why did you want to cover? You had written for Mother Jones and the Nation. You'd written for progressive journals.
Yeah, I guess, you know, I'm a failed social scientist, and I had read this book when I came back called The Micro Millennium, which was written by a British author, and it was sort of this manifesto about the impact that the microprocessor was going to have on society. And I just used that as my roadmap for reporting. And, you know, he was remarkably prescient. It turns out the microprocessor did change the world. And I followed that as a story for many years.
It's funny. I think in a similar way, George Gilder's Microcosm very much influenced me.
That's right. That's right.
And I think the same kind of thread throughout, that this technology is kind of contrary to anything we've seen before. It gets cheaper and faster and smaller.
Well, and remember, the point is not that it gets cheaper and faster. It gets cheaper, faster, and faster. That's the nature of an exponential.
Right.
And that was what was so much fun. And there was this free ride, essentially, that the industry got for five decades, you know, as we moved down the Moore's Law curve. And the question now is it over? It's been a great ride.
Is it?
Well, I've argued that it's paused. I mean, it's complicated, but there are a whole set of indicators that suggest that we're dealing with what happens to all exponentials. They become S-curves. In particular, over the last 2 years, the cost of transistors, per transistor cost in silicon, has not fallen. And that was the principal sort of, you know, metric for that free ride, is that you could, you know, and Intel called it its TikTok strategy. They would shrink the design, and then they would come up with a new design. They shrink the design, and they did that for decades. And then all of a sudden, last year, they came to a halt, and they've essentially fallen off the curve. There's a big debate about whether you can innovate in other ways, but you don't get the free ride from just turning the crank anymore. You know, used to be you could design something and then you knew its cost was going to fall just one generation later. So every 18 months, the number of transistors on a piece of silicon doubled, and that happened like clockwork for a long, long time, and it's not happening at the moment. You know, there are other sort of, originally people thought they were going to, the supercomputer guys thought they were going to get to exascale computing in 2018, and that's probably 5 years late before they'll actually have working exascale computers. There's also this thing called dark silicon, which it's a term I love. It turns out that you can't use all the transistors on a microprocessor now simultaneously, or they melt. And so you have to have these complicated algorithms to use some of the transistors, and so you don't get the full effects right now. That's another artifact.
We're talking to John Markoff, late of the New York Times. He's now at the Computer History Museum and is writing a book about Stewart Brand. We're going to talk more about that. One of the reasons I love talking to John, and one of the reasons he's so missed, frankly, at the New York Times and was so valuable at the New York Times, is this deep, as you can see, this deep understanding of the technology and of the sociology and of how it's intertwined. I mean, I think there's no one better than you, John, at kind of understanding what's going on. It's easy to report the bits and bytes, but to understand its implications is much more difficult and challenging, especially as it's happening.
And to predict where things are going. I mean, one of the great things about being a reporter is you don't have to be a visionary. You just have to write down what people claim is going to happen 5 years from now and then point out that they were wrong.
I learned early on to stop predicting. It's almost impossible because everything is, you know, is so, I hate to use the phrase, but I guess I have to, paradigm shift. It's a cliff. It falls off cliffs and you just don't know what cliff you're going to fall off.
Correct.
Next, or maybe I shouldn't use cliffs. A curve, which curve you're going to go up next? I do sometimes get the feeling, though, that that what really happened was there was such go acceleration that the wheels fell off. That cases like Uber, these unicorns, Theranos, Facebook's dominance, Google, Microsoft trying to find its way. These are kind of late stage situations that were kind of the in hindsight, the obvious result of this incredible acceleration.
Yeah, you know, what's been fascinating to me is that at regular points, people have found choke points. And for example, DOS was a choke point, right? Microsoft managed to sort of ride this monopoly for a long, long time. What they had was the choke point to the information on your disk in DOS. And I often joke that the only difference between Microsoft's MS-DOS command prompt and Google's search query is that you can make spelling errors with Google. But they both found choke points, and they both extracted monopoly rents out of them. Yeah. So the question is, what's the next choke point?
Well, it's interesting you should say that, because Ben Thompson's most recent article in Stratechery kind of talks about the choke point that is now Facebook. He calls it a funnel, but it's somewhat similar, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Although they've monetized their ability to, you know, your family relationships, I guess, is what they've extracted rent from, or are extracting rent from. I assume the next one will come from whatever's happening in the Internet of Things world, but I don't think that's emerged yet.
Yeah. That's what's fun about this job and why you never get bored, because there's always something, and it changes so rapidly. We'll take a little break. We got more with John Markoff. He's joining us from his office at the New York Times. Well, I want to talk. I need to understand that a little bit better, because last I heard, you'd retired from the New York Times. But we'll talk about that in just a second. Our show today is brought to you by Betterment, and I am not allowed by the rules of the Securities and Exchange Commission to be a Betterment customer. It's one of the few sponsors we have that I can't actually use, and it's driving me nuts. But and I think this is sufficiently hands off. You know, my mom is 83. She's retired. She's been paying a lot of money to manage her money, a ridiculous amount of money. And so I told Lisa, if you want to take over my mom's stuff, please do. And don't tell me what you're going to do. But I think it's probably going to be Betterment. This is just a much more sensible way to invest. Make sure you and your family are set for financial success with Betterment. It's the largest independent automated investment service. They've got $5.5 billion under management, over 180,000 customers. And what it is, it's computers managing your portfolio, designed to achieve optimal results at every level of investment. Nice thing about Betterment, no minimum to sign up. And their goal-based investment framework and advice algorithm can tell you immediately when you go to the page, betterment.com/triangulation, if you're on the right track, and help you manage your investments to save up to 600% on fees. And of course, there's never any trade, transaction, or rebalancing fees. To keep an eye on the rest of your investments, because you can sync them all into your Betterment dashboard, so you'll know your total net worth in a single place. Through diversification, through automated rebalancing, through lower fees, Betterment customers can expect 4.3% higher returns than the typical DIY investor. Smart deposits mean you can automatically invest excess cash. That's a really great way to grow your nest egg. They have a retire guide, which provides a consolidated view of your retirement, calculates your gap, lets you know what you need to do to make your goals. And of course, every time you make a deposit or receive dividends, Betterment will intelligently rebalance your portfolio. The single most important thing, the thing people always know they should do but forget. Betterment's tax loss harvesting also helps lower investment taxes, increase after-tax returns. And end-to-end investing means faster cash transfers, tax forms available at the earliest possible date, secure investing. And there are humans, support specialists available 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Investing involves risk. Right now, get 1 month managed free when you make an initial deposit of $10,000 or more. To learn more, go to betterment.com/triangulation. Betterment.com/triangulation. I think it's safe to say the dean of technology reporting, John Markoff, is my guest. A man I look up to and have ever since you were editor at Byte Magazine in 1984. That's when I first got published in Byte Magazine, when the Macintosh came out. Worked at the Examiner, wrote about Silicon Valley, and then, of course, the New York Times since 1988. It was your first year at the Times. You scored a major scoop, according to Wikipedia. If Wikipedia is wrong, correct me.
A usually reliable source. was that the Morris worm?
Yeah, the Morris worm. The really first network worm anybody had ever heard of.
Well, the significant thing about the 1988 event, which was, you know, 50,000 computers made up the entire internet at that point, and it largely came to a halt. But it really was the first time that our society as a whole had any sense that this thing called networking was coming and was going to have an impact on the world, and you know, in both a positive and negative way. But the power of networking sort of was on display in that event.
Yeah. And, of course, the guy who wrote the worm was the son of an NSA cryptographer. that was kind
well, of... Well, the chief scientist of the NSA, wow. Bob Morris, yeah. a pioneering, one of the initial Unix design teams had gone to the NSA, and he was their chief scientist, which made it a much better story.
Yeah. Well, but it's a great story because Robert Tappan Morris, the creator of the worm, didn't really know, or at least the way he tells it, he didn't really expect it. He wasn't trying to create a network virus. He just thought, well, this is interesting. I wonder if this will propagate.
And yeah, that's exactly right. He was trying to do Kilroy is here.
Right.
And it just got a little out of hand, and it's fascinating to see what he didn't understand. He didn't understand the ecology of network systems. If you know, he had this very complex system. He discovered a vulnerability I guess it was a flavor of Unix, but he began thinking like a war gamer. He said, "Well, if I was going to defeat my worm, what would I do?" And I would say, "I'm here, even though I wasn't here." And so he decided to go one in X times, even if he was there. And what was X? If X had been 7 million, it would have been great. No one would have ever heard of his, but he picked 7. 7 was the wrong number.
Oops. And it spread. It's
quickly.
I mean, and look, 88, I mean, that was what, 38 years ago?
28 years ago.
Almost 30 years ago. And it was really, if you could read into it, kind of a warning of what was to come. Do you think that?
At the time, there were people who were making that point, but it was largely a group of science fiction writers who were writing this class of science fiction known as cyber science fiction. Right. So go back and read Werner Vinge. Vinge wrote a book called True Names, a wonderful little novella, which is still relevant today about the questions of trust and anonymity when you assume a world where you have infinite bandwidth and infinite computing power.
Vinge was kind of the science fiction writer's science fiction writer. He was the guy all the other guys said, this is the guy. And I don't know if he was as widely beloved by the public.
Maybe he was a little bit more inside, but there were also people like Neal Stephenson and William Gibson. And they were, you know, for me, it was life imitating art. The things I was reading in their science fiction books, I was seeing in what I was reporting.
Right. You reported early about the World Wide Web. According to Wikipedia, you called it the map to the buried treasures of the information age. That's a 93. Well,
that was 93. I believe that was the first article about the World Wide Web, December 7th, 1993. And that lead, think of it as a map to the buried treasures of the information age, was a question. It was sort of a case of getting it all right and all wrong at the same time. When I used the word buried treasure, I have to admit I was thinking information. I wasn't thinking treasure, and it was treasure. Within 3 years, the dot-com world had exploded, and the web had become Main Street. And I was run over by, you know, the gaggle of people who came to cover the modern internet. And, you know, by 1997, if it hadn't have been for Monica Lewinsky, the press would have written about nothing but the internet that year.
Yeah, interesting. Do you feel like you I think some tech journalists might feel this way, that you watch this all happen. If you had been canny, you might have abandoned journalism and invested.
Well, or become a venture capitalist. I had that opportunity a couple of times.
Do you wish you had?
You know, business people have to go to too many meetings for my taste.
That's discovered too. I watched it all happen. I can't pretend that I had any insight that ahead of time that would have been a valuable investment strategy. But I watched a lot of people. I once had a guy drive up in a Rolls Royce to one of our shows and say, "You bought me that." I said, "What?" He said, "Yeah, you were talking about Zipdisk, about iOmega, and I bought the stock." Of course, I said, "I hope you got out of it in time too, because it crashed."
That's right.
And that's
there are Intel engineers who bought million-dollar Porsches, if you remember.
Yeah, yeah. I wonder where they are now. I don't know can you pick some threads out of? I mean, you've been watching this for 30 years. Are there some insights that you gather, like some global insights you've gathered that you think maybe people aren't?
Well. Yeah, so in Machines of Loving Grace, one of the things that I picked up on that I'd written about sort of noticed 15 years earlier when I wrote Dormouse. You know, at the very dawn of interactive computing in the early 1960s, there were two laboratories set up on either side of the Stanford campus. One was started by John McCarthy. It was called the Stanford Artificial Intelligence Laboratory. And he set out to replace the human. He thought at that time in 62 it would take 10 years to build the thinking machine. He was a little optimistic. And at exactly the same time on the other side of campus, a guy named Doug Engelbart, who you probably know as the inventor of the mouse, but also he did the first sort of real interactive computing systems design. He came up with this concept of IA, intelligence augmentation. And, you know, if you want a sort of good example of what that is, think personal computer. I mean, Steve Jobs probably came up with the most evocative phrase when he called personal computers a bicycle for the mind. And I think that dichotomy is still playing out today. You know, do we design people into or out of systems? And I guess my point in my book was that it was a human choice. These machines, despite the belief by some people in Silicon Valley, I don't think these machines are evolving on their own. These are the products of human designers. And, right now, there's going to be fascinating decisions made by companies like IBM and Microsoft who are designing artificial intelligence platforms for their customers. And they have to decide what the role of humans is going to be and whether there will be a role for humans. But it's a human choice. For example, Microsoft has a big call center business, and you can do two different things with these conversational agents. You can replace humans, or you can make better human call center operators. And that's a design decision. And I'm going to be fascinated to see which they choose.
Yeah, so it's really an important point, because I think a lot of us just say, oh, well, it's just inevitable. There's a sense of inevitability, and this is all just kind of happening on its own. So it's important to think that we're not at the mercy of this, that we actually, not only is it a human choice, but we can influence those choices.
Agreed. I have a good friend, Kevin Kelly, who's written a book called The Inevitable, and we have a distinct philosophical difference on what the human role is in the future of these systems.
We had a great conversation a few months ago with Kevin on the show, actually, about the inevitable. Kevin has that mindset, right? It's just going to happen. And so, and here's how you prepare for it. We have a lot of people on the show who kind of have that point of view. Here's how you prepare for it. But maybe we should step back now and start thinking, is this what we want? You look at something like, okay, let's talk about the times. And then, because I'm thinking of the stories that you must really want to write that you can't be writing right now. You left the Times. Was it a retirement? You took a buyout, right?
I did take a buyout, and so I guess it wasn't a retirement, but it was an early retirement. I mean, I'm over 65, and so, it seemed that I like doing longer form journalism, and the opportunity to do this biography of Stewart Brand came along, and it's so much focused on a set of events that happened in Northern California during my lifetime. It just seemed like a really fun project, so I decided that's what I'd do for the next couple of years.
So that's your full-time pursuit. We also read shortly after that you went to the Computer History Museum, but is that part of this project?
Well, I've always volunteered for the last decade or so. I've volunteered at the Computer History Museum. I like doing oral histories, I've moderated panels for them, and I'm continuing to do that as well.
That's the one in Mountain View that started by Gordon Bell.
Right? Gordon and Gwen Bell originally started it in Boston, and they moved it out here. Yeah. And it's right across the street from Google. It's off the 101 corridor, and it's great fun. They just opened a new software exhibit. They have a sort of very large hardware exhibit. People are surprised at how large it is, and now they've added software to it. So it's a fun place to go.
I have to get down there. I think you get eclipsed a little bit by the tech down the road in San Jose. And people forget that there's this amazing museum. Are you in one of the hangars that's there?
No. Well, they were out on at NASA Moffett Field for a while, but they've moved into an old SGI building.
Okay.
It's directly off the freeway, and it's spectacular. You know, it's also the stuff in the evening that they do, and there's stuff happening all the time. It's kind of Silicon Valley's clubhouse.
Right.
And
I went to a Ford event there actually when they were trying to woo engineers to design stuff for Ford Sync. And there's some amazing displays to see those. I wonder, though, if I feel like our kids, and my kids are in their 20s, don't have a lot of interest in the in these early days of computing. They seem so primitive to them, you know.
Well, it's funny because that those exhibits are populated with kids.
Oh, good.
They're always full of kids running around. So,
oh, good.
You can go see Shaky the Robot. It was the very first autonomous robotic platform. Kind of fun.
There's an exhibit on Hidden Figures too, right? I think that's there.
I haven't seen it. If it is,
I think they have something about Hidden Figures. So, so you left the Times. You're working on the Stewart Brand book. But you must look at stories like the Uber story that's broken in the last couple of weeks and say, gosh, I wish I could be writing about this. Or no. Maybe you prefer not.
No, yes. You're right. Actually, the story, the Uber story, man, there's a certain class of stories where I feel like, I've done this for the last 30 years. I don't need to do this anymore. Actually, 40 years, but who's counting?
Like a sports writer, how many times,
Very much that way. But then there's other stuff. Like there's a debate going on about the role of this organization called Cambridge Analytica that I've just followed from a distance. But it's really remarkable, if true, if they did have that kind of influence. That represents something new, I think.
I reported it or talked about it when it first came out that they had a huge influence. And then there were stories debunking that, saying that it was all marketing speak. And then just yesterday or today, and there's a news story saying, oh, no, they're brilliant. And I can't figure. So this is where we need you, John. We need people to dig and find out what the real story is.
Yeah, hopefully people are doing that.
Yes. Times has some very good people. I'm not knocking any of them. They have in fact, Times really has done a great job under your tenure and continues on to covering technology. One of the best, frankly.
Well, it's extraordinary how different. I mean, I'm sitting in the San Francisco Bureau, and there are probably 12 reporters around me or tech writers, and I was once the only tech writer with a stringer in Silicon Valley.
Wow. What do you think the biggest story you covered was?
Oh, I guess it depends on the generation.
Start with the 90s. It's got to be the web,
the 90s,
right?
Well, there was the web, there was the Morris worm, there was the Clipper chip, were all stories I broke during the 90s that come to mind.
The Clipper chip was the encryption with a government back door that Al Gore and others wanted to build into TVs.
That's right. They would make it your conversation. It was originally voice conversations more than data, but that was always implicit. That was before the web had existed. And what's remarkable is that the same debate is going on. We still haven't solved that problem. The tension between surveillance and security and privacy is going to be with us for a long time, I think.
It feels like and this might be where you're wiping your brow. It feels like in the last year, stuff has come so fast and furious that it's almost impossible to do it justice. It might be nice to sit back and not be a day-to-day reporter.
Well, at the same time, Silicon Valley has this kind of religion of progress, and I think sometimes it's more the marketing department than stuff that actually happens.
Yeah.
I mean, I was in that camp in the beginning, I guess, 2010, 2011, the early reporting I did about the progress that AI has been making, machine intelligence was working when it had not worked previously and beginning to have an impact. And so for a while, I was part of that community that had their hair on fire. There is a group of people who believe that there will be no jobs that are left for humans to do by 2045. And I've really come around. I've done a 180-degree turn on that, and I'm much more skeptical about the progress. I mean, first of all, Keynes said in the 1930s that technology destroys jobs but not work. And the simple fact is that here we are in 2017, and there are more people working in America than ever in history. That's something that the people who make these wild claims have to deal with. There's still a lot of jobs out there, and you'd think you'd sort of see them disappearing if they were really going away. And you can get into the weeds on this argument very quickly, but I was one of those people who did have my hair on fire, and I was having this argument with Danny Kahneman, who's this well-known behavioral economist who's a Nobel Prize winner, and I was making this argument with respect to manufacturing and robots in China. And he stopped me, and he said, and I was basically saying they're going to cause social disruption in China, the advent of robotics. He said, you don't get it. He said, in China, they'll be lucky if the robots come just in time. And I said, excuse me? And he walked me through the demographic situation of modern China, and it really reframed my way of thinking about robotics. I mean, in China, in the last year, the working age workforce has shrunk by 5 million people. And so you have not only less workers, but there's this thing called the dependency ratio, the ratio of people who need care to who give care. And China is such a rapidly aging society that they're going to need more caregivers, and it's not clear where they're going to come from. So it's a much more subtle situation than people who say, you know, robots are going to take our jobs would have you believe.
You cover this in Machines of Loving Grace. Is this the kind of...
I do. Yeah. This is what I struggle with.
Yeah. You also were one of the first to write pre-Snowden about TIA, about total information awareness, and the attempts of the government to know exactly what was going on at every electronic juncture.
Yeah, the total information awareness story. I mean, so John Poindexter came back to DARPA after 9/11 with the idea of building the system that would allow you to basically harvest virtually all kinds of data and find people who were a threat in your data, and it's gone so far from there. I mean, so absolutely far from there in terms of the nature of the surveillance society that I don't even know how to I don't even know how to think about it anymore. We have TIA. It's all around us. Yeah, and it's not just Big Brother, it's Little Brother too.
It's so interesting that you wrote about it, but it wasn't until Snowden's revelations that I think people really became aware of it. It was weird because we knew about it.
Yeah, we didn't know about it.
I don't know what it was, but Snowden said, but it was like we suddenly woke up.
Yeah, I mean, if you'd been paying attention, everything that Snowden brought into the light had been reported by us or USA Today or the Wall Street Journal. All of the basics were out there. I think it was just very striking that it came out and became a political threat to the establishment.
Yeah. It's your opinion that Admiral Poindexter achieved his goal, that we do have TIA.
Well, so the question is, how well does the technology work? Clearly, the surveillance apparatus is there. It's not clear to me that you can actually find the needles in the haystack as easily as the big data miners would have you believe.
That's the problem, right? You build this giant data center and you collect every bit of information. Now what do you do? Now what do you do with it? How do you understand it?
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what this current administration does with respect to privacy and security, and to what extent our Fourth Amendment values are maintained in the next decade.
One of the things that we've seen is a kind of a split between the intelligence community and the executive, and that seems dangerous in weird ways that I'm not sure I fully understand. What do you think about the what do they call it, the dark
the deep state?
The deep state.
This is something I haven't been reporting on a lot in the last 4 or 5 years. I've been off in AI and robotics and not really dealing with the intelligence community. Yeah, it's possible.
Quite possible. Best not to deal. We're talking to John Markoff, Pulitzer Prize winner in 2013 for explanatory reporting. I like that. That's maybe one of the, in technology, anyway, one of the most important things you can do. I did a series of articles on Apple and other technology companies and their business practices. John retired from full-time work at the Times, although you're still freelancing there, and that's why you're in the offices, I gather.
That's right.
What kind of stories are you doing for the Times?
Well, the most recent story was a piece about the rate of progress the Chinese have been making in developing artificial intelligence and robotics technologies independently from the United States. And it's something of a debate over the rate at which the Chinese are going to be independently innovative from the United States and how much they're going to be a direct competitor as opposed to being a fast follower.
Interesting.
I was there for the first time in a while in 2016, and I found China remarkable in many ways. And I think that we would be mistaken to underestimate the rate of progress in China. in Beijing, it felt to me as if Silicon Valley had infected China. And there is an entrepreneurial frenzy in China, which is palpable. Yeah. And the scale is just extraordinary. 4 million startup companies in China last year, 1.7 million of them are technology companies. And you have a feeling that in some ways they've already surpassed us. I mean, take a service like WeChat and compare it to Facebook and get a sense of how the Chinese use WeChat. I mean, it's kind of Facebook and PayPal mashed up, and they're using it's woven totally into the, at least in urban China, into the everyday commercial life of tens of millions of Chinese.
I was there about 5 years ago. I had the same, even back then, the same reaction. This is a country on the move, really exciting. But I remember also talking to locals who said, yeah, but we have all these structural issues like this, you know, declining birth rate, pollution. Yeah. I've always been fascinated by China, and it's something we're going to have to watch with great interest. I'm glad you're covering it, frankly. We'll come back and take a break and come back and talk about machines of loving grace, artificial intelligence, our human role in the future with our guest, John Markoff. In just a moment. I can't wait. Our show today brought to you by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. Computers are everywhere. And one of the places I think it's a natural fit is in the mortgage approval process. Quicken Loans has for the long, long time been the number one mortgage lender, at least in terms of customer satisfaction. Just look at all those J.D. Power awards year after year after year, both with loan origination and mortgage servicing. They are, I think, the number two lender in the country, and they are transparent. They're trustworthy. But what I love is they also love technology, and they have created a new mortgage product that you're going to want to know about, Rocket Mortgage. Next time you want to buy or refi, wouldn't you like to do the whole thing online? No visit to a bank or a lender, no going through paperwork, boxes of paperwork, and finding check stubs and bank statements. You can do it all online. You can do it all on your phone from the couch and submit all of the paperwork you need electronically. There's even, because, you know, it's very friction-free, there's even buttons that let you modify your term and your rate, get it just right, and then within minutes, get loan approval. In the video here on the site, they show a couple that goes to an open house and they say, honey, we should buy this. They literally apply for the loan at the open house and show the realtor, oh, we're approved. It is that fast. It is that easy. I know a number of people now who've used it and are just, blown away. The last time we bought a house, it took 6 weeks. How about 6 minutes? Quickenloans.com/triangulation. Skip the bank. Skip the waiting. Go completely online. Quickenloans.com/triangulation. Equal housing lender licensed in all 50 states. NMLSconsumerAccess.org number 3030, we think. Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans for their support. Quickenloans.com/triangulation. Machines of Loving Grace is John's latest book, The Quest for Common Ground Between Humans and Robots. And I love it that you say we have a choice. Because I think so many of us, including Kevin Kelly, feel like this is just... He said when he was on the show, what you're going to see is just machine learning spread like a thin layer of peanut butter on every technology we've got. And it's just gonna spread.
I think that in a sense he's right, but humans are gonna stay in the mix. Yeah. In a way you can go all the way to back to Marx. I mean, you do need in a capitalist society, you do need consumers. You do need somebody to buy the products. The robots can't buy all the products themselves, and so it's a complex question. And I don't think humans are going to be out of the loop as quickly as some of the optimists in Silicon Valley believe.
Well, and one way the optimists in Silicon Valley want to solve this is with something like universal basic income, which almost seems like a perpetual motion machine to me. I don't really understand how it's supposed to work.
Yeah, and I think all the UBI debate is a fascinating one. And actually, there are experiments happening. I mean, I believe Y Combinator is running an experiment in the East Bay. And there have been similar experiments run in India in rural settings. And what was fascinating there, and in terms of our beliefs about human behavior and human nature, is they found, I think, in some of these village experiments they did, that giving people a base foundation income did not make them did not enervate them, did not make them lazy.
Right.
It tended to be a foundation in which they became actually more entrepreneurial. So, you know, it's clearly not going to happen in the United States in the next half decade, right?
Right.
It's just not on the political agenda. And in fact, it's not clear to me that it's the right solution. What's striking to me about sort of this wave of internet technologies is when you talk about the Ubers and the other kinds of just-in-time services companies that are disaggregating things, is a generation of people who have to retrain themselves constantly and reinvent their careers over and over and over again. That kind of world, and it's still not clear to me that it's as pervasive as some people say it will be, but that kind of world is a very different world than the one you and I grew up in, where we've basically been doing the same thing for our entire careers. Actually, the guy who does the best job in describing that world is a British science fiction writer whose name is Charlie Strauss, who's written a wonderful collection of short stories. You only have to read the first one, but I really recommend that people read Accelerando to understand what it's going to be like to live in the gig economy of the short of the near future. Not a world I would feel very comfortable with, but I see things in the valley that suggest that we're on our way there sometimes.
I think that, you know, people like Mark Andreessen, it feels like hand-waving to me when Andreessen says, well, don't worry because productivity is going to go up so much, the cost of goods is going to be so low, and it's all going to just work out.
Yeah, that's dreaming. You know, I don't know what these guys think they're getting their data sources from on productivity, but there is this guy named Robert Solow, who in the 1980s, when personal computers were first around, talked about what has become known as the Solow paradox. And that is, he said, computers, personal computers are everywhere except in the productivity statistics. And take a look at what's happened to productivity globally during this time, which we were supposed to be having these wild exponential changes in computing power. And productivity has actually gone down dramatically during the last 30 years. So what's that about? I mean, just obviously it's a much more complex explanation than simply saying computing power will make us more productive.
Yeah. Do you feel like people are addressing these issues and that policymakers understand it and that we're doing what we need to do, or what would your prescription be?
It doesn't look, I mean, well, it doesn't look like Washington has a good handle on what's going on. President Obama, for example, in 2011, sort of made the claim that the rise of ATMs had this dire impact on bank tellers, which, you know, common wisdom would suggest that that's probably true. But actually, if you look at what's really happened, and that's the falling cost of communications and the falling cost of computing, has made it possible for banks to put a branch on every corner. There are many branch banks as there are Starbucks. And what they like to have is a human facing the customer.
Right.
And so the number of tellers has actually stayed constant in the
How
face of new technology. What's changed is that the people who work in the back office, it's like a neutron bomb went off. And there's an entire clerk class of the people who used to shuffle paper inside corporations and banks who have gone away. So there has been a dramatic change. And that's probably the most troubling aspect of this wave of automation, is it's actually creating more inequality. And there's this danger, apparently a real danger, of losing the middle class, of having people pushed to the top and the bottom of the economic structure.
Right. What do you do to solve that? Is it retraining? Well, is it preparing for the gig economy? What do you tell your kids?
Yeah, so there are all kinds of interesting experiments. I mean, remember, we all used to go to the same public schools, and education was not stratified, and that was one of the best things about our democracy, as far as I could see. And, you know, people like a friend of mine, Jerry Kaplan, who's written books on AI recently and who was an AI pioneer, have been thinking about ways to redistribute wealth in interesting ways and sort of giving incentives. I mean, Bill Gates was recently talking about taxing robots,
yeah.
And I'm not sure if you're going to be able to tax robots. You have to decide what a robot is to tax it, and it's very complicated. Companies already pay taxes on profits.
It's double taxing,
You could argue that, yeah. Jerry had a different approach. Jerry had the idea of creating incentives for companies to distribute ownership. And so pushing out equity at the companies who are willing to to disseminate their ownership. And that's an intriguing idea to me. I don't know if it'll happen in this current climate, but I think it might be the kind of policy approach that would work. I love things that are not, the behavioral economists talk about these ideas of nudging people toward behaviors rather than basically creating rules, encouraging them with incentives. And that seems like an interesting low friction way to change behavior and maybe distribute wealth.
So there are people who probably everybody in Silicon Valley believe that Silicon Valley is and the way we have of thinking of things and fail fast and, you know, all of that is the right way to do it. It's the new way to do it, and everything should be done this way. I look at Mark Zuckerberg and other technologists who seem to be showing some interest in running the country, for instance. Yeah. And I wonder if those are actually the lessons to take away from Silicon Valley. Look, you've been watching it. You watched it birth and evolve. Is Silicon Valley all that it thinks it is?
Well, I've read the literature. I mean, there's now a rich literature trying to explain what Silicon Valley is. And there are, you know, there are books that sort of say it's about organizational structure. Your point about failing fast. It's our ability compared to some parts of the world to reward failure.
Yeah.
Failure is not a badge of failure in Silicon Valley. And that's about a culture. Workers in Silicon Valley generally believe that they work for Silicon Valley Inc. and they're willing to drive in a new driveway. I mean, there are all these cultural things. It was a magnet for the world's best and brightest. That's one of the things I worry about, because I saw that era of Silicon Valley. This was before H-1B visas. There were two things that sort of woke me up to Silicon Valley. One was going to a meeting of something called the Big Blue Computer Club in Sunnyvale in Dyson Auditorium in 1982 after the IBM PC had been introduced. And a San Jose Mercury reporter, whose name was Evelyn Richards, got up on stage and interviewed like these 300 nerds who were out in the audience. And literally, they wore white shirts and they had pocket protectors because that was the culture of the time.
Yeah.
And she asked them at one point, how many of you are planning on starting your own company? And 2/3 of the hands went up.
Wow.
And that's when I got Silicon Valley for the first time. Everybody thought that they were one good idea away from being Steve Jobs.
Right.
And the other thing that sort of tuned me into Silicon Valley was in Sunnyvale in 1984 when I was at Byte, walking into this bakery and discovering it was an Indian bakery because there was an Indian community, because there was a disk drive industry and it was being populated with Indian engineers.
Right.
And when I was at InfoWorld, I saw a lot of that people had this gold rush mentality. They would just show up because they knew this was the place. And that culture, I think, is easy to break. And I worry about that.
What's surprising to me is how geographically focused it still is. You would expect it to, I mean, spread a little bit. You've got Austin, you've got Seattle, you've got, well, not so much Boston anymore, but it really does seem to be focused in San Francisco and South Bay.
But that's interesting. I mean, so Richard Florida, who's a social scientist, has done this wonderful piece of research where he geolocated the center of Silicon Valley by current venture capital investment about a year and a half ago. Where do you think the center of Silicon Valley is now?
Well, San Francisco, right?
It's at the foot of Potrero Hill, literally.
And yeah, I used to work there. That's where,
But it wasn't then when you worked there.
Probably not.
I mean, then somebody went back and reverse engineered what he did and found the center of Silicon Valley in 1984. And what's there now today is a storage locker facility. And the reason it's there in Santa Clara, and the reason it's there is because it's a toxic waste dump underneath and they can't build housing under it because it was a fab. You know, it was a fab in 1984.
Wow.
In 2006, I was spending a lot of time in Europe, and I felt that there was more mobile innovation there than there was in Silicon Valley. And I had this sense of the next platform potentially. You remember Symbian and people like emerging somewhere else. And then 2007, the iPhone shows up, and the center and the platform comes right back here. But I don't think it's a given. I don't think it's that the next generation platform won't come from some other part of the world.
People like Loic Lemur and others have spent a lot of time speculating about why Europe isn't as fertile for startups as Silicon Valley. It seems to be cultural.
Yeah, this is this notion of culture of rewarding failure, which is, I think, largely unique to Silicon Valley. And it's not true of Route 128 companies that may be more traditional, maybe more hierarchical, and certainly not true of Europe. And, you know, the regulatory structures obviously make it more difficult for companies to move quickly. You know, and Silicon Valley, the venture capital industry was enabled by legislative changes that allowed big institutions to put aside some sort of their investment for risk capital. And that was a big deal.
We're talking John Markoff. His most recent book, it's actually, I can't believe it's already a couple of years old, Machines of Loving Grace. And it's all about artificial intelligence, humans, and the role of the common ground, the quest for common ground between humans and robots. He's working on a new biography of really one of the most interesting and greatest guys, and such an influence to many of us, Stewart Brand. And I want to hear a little bit about that. I also would love to pick your brain as we got one more segment as to what companies we've had the four or five horsemen of the internet, and what companies among those will survive and thrive in the future, because they all seem to be at middle age now, you know. And our show is brought to you today by Blue Apron. I had Blue Apron last night. I had a wonderful tempura cod. It was so good with a kale salad. Blue Apron, this is one of those Silicon Valley inventions that's just taken off like crazy. The idea that instead of sending you a frozen meal that somebody else cooked, sending you the ingredients took an amazing meal from scratch. You can do it yourself with a recipe card and everything. All the ingredients you need, no more, no less, so there's no waste. At a price that's less than the grocery store. You just pay about 60% more at the grocery store because, you know, Blue Apron doesn't have a brick-and-mortar business. They don't have clerks and all that stuff. They just ship you the ingredients. And it supports, you know, a sustainable food system. They buy from local farms, 150 farms, fisheries, and ranchers across the U.S. The seafood is sourced sustainably. The beef, the chicken, the pork come from responsibly raised animals. Produce is sourced from farms that practice regenerative farming. It's really good stuff, the stuff you would buy, and you get it for less, and you get exactly what you want. And it's kind of an adventure. And I probably shouldn't say that, because some people say, I don't want an adventure, I just want to have dinner. And, you know, frankly, that's why at the end of the day, instead of planning a meal and shopping and cooking, we go to Applebee's. But maybe it would be fun, especially if you've got the kids, to cook a few times a week, to cook something amazing. You don't have to plan it. You just go to blueapron.com and pick your meal. You get to always get to choose. There's no weekly commitment. You only get deliveries when you want them. Salmon piccata with orzo and broccoli. I mean, that's luscious. In fact, I think that's the one we have waiting for us. Pork chops and miso butter with bok choy and marinated apple. Vegetable chili and baked sweet potatoes with crispy tortilla strips. The other day, I made an udon soup, a noodle soup, that blew my mind. And what's wonderful about it, in the case of the soup, you know, you have ginger and garlic, and you're sautéing it up to put in the soup, and the whole house fills with this amazing fragrance. There it is, this amazing fragrance, and it's a wonderful feeling. You're cooking for people you love. You're learning a new skill, and next time I'm going to make more udon soup. I know how to do it now. Check out this week's menu. We'll get you your first three meals free with your first purchase and free shipping if you go to blueapron.com/triangulation. blueapron.com/triangulation, the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. Their mission to make incredible home cooking accessible to all, including you. You can do it, and it's fun, and it's a great feeling of accomplishment. blueapron.com/triangulation. John Markoff is my guest. Really, the dean of tech reporters, a guy you know, I admire so much, been so inspired by over the years, and I'm thrilled to get you back on our microphones. We haven't had you here in so long. I'm glad to hear you're writing a book about the great Stewart Brand as well. Not only did the Whole Earth Catalog, and of course, Steve Jobs famously quoted him in that commencement address he gave in Stanford, "Stay hungry, stay foolish," right?
That's correct.
And that was on the back, wasn't it, of the Whole Earth Catalog?
That's right.
I remember it on my parents' coffee table. I'm a little younger than you, but I remember the first one on the coffee table. I remember the last one on the coffee table. I remember flipping through it, and it was just a, you know, farm implement. It was just all sorts of stuff.
It was kind of the web before the web.
It was like the web in a book.
Yeah.
And I bought many of those things. And still to this day, you know, I kind of cherish the memories of the Whole Earth Catalog. Where did Stewart come from?
So Stewart grew up in Illinois. He was sort of raised, his family was, the background was a Michigan family, sort of upper class in a way. I mean, he went to Exeter for a couple of years and then he went to Stanford in the 50s. And then after Stanford, he went into the Army and he was a paratrooper and ended up back in the Bay Area in 1961.
But he obviously embraced the counterculture.
Well, he created the counterculture.
Okay.
In a very specific
way. Fair enough.
Way.
Yeah.
You know, the counterculture in some ways grew out of these things called the acid tests. This is Ken Kesey and the Merry Pranksters and their house band, which is the Grateful Dead. Yeah. And Stewart organized in many ways what was the most visible and most impactful of the acid test. It was called the Trips Festival. And in a very specific way, it was the Trips Festival, which was held at the Longshoremen Hall in San Francisco in 1966. LSD was still legal at that point. But it was that point that Bill Graham realized that there was a business in music and went on to create the Fillmore directly as a result of the Trips Festival.
Wow. Wow. And of course, Steve Jobs famously said that acid was a key ingredient in his worldview and felt sorry for people who hadn't taken it.
He said that to me, actually. That was one of, you know, there was a period when Steve had come back to Apple and he was introducing products at a really rapid rate. And I have regular interviews with him. And we play this game with him trying to stay on message and me trying to get him off message.
What fun.
And that was one of the best gets. He said that acid was one of the two or three most significant things in his life. And because of that, there were people people like his wife and the corporate people that he dealt with who didn't understand his world.
Right.
Completely.
Right. And now Silicon Valley's microdosing again.
Oh my! Yeah, it's really quite remarkable. Ed Waldman has written this book on microdosing. And Jim Fadiman, who actually was the person who took Stewart Brand on his first LSD trip, again when it was legal, in the early 1960s, is sort of responsible for this renewed interest in the impact and the effect of psychedelics.
What was Stewart's reaction when you said, "I want to write a biography"?
Well, Stewart had spent a half a decade thinking about writing an autobiography, and he decided it was just too big of a project. He didn't want to take it on. And actually, it was Kevin Kelly who suggested the idea that I do it. It was Kevin's idea. And Stewart was quite happy to have me take up the project, and he's been great. We've been spending time together. His archives are at Stanford. There are journals. There's lots of stuff that he's done. You know, this guy is a sort of a thoughtful intellectual who's been active over a half a century. There's a lot of material there.
I can't wait to read it. So you've watched, you know, as Microsoft rose to ascendancy, became dominant and then became less dominant. Google then rising up, Apple rising, falling, rising again. The surprising emergence of Amazon. These are all companies, though, that are, you know, in tech terms, in middle age now.
Yeah, I agree. And you know, there's a big deal being made out of the control of data. All of these companies are trying to build these big vertical stacks of behavioral information about people and trying to use it to monetize their customer base in different ways. And so there's a couple of questions. I mean, one is, I mean, I remember being around Microsoft's executives when they were literally laughing at IBM's behavior and saying, you know, this is never going to happen to us. And what was so striking is that, you know, companies get trapped in their paradigms and they can't, for a variety of reasons, leave them. And it happened to Microsoft, even though they were fully aware of what had beset their predecessor. And at the same time, almost nobody sees the threats coming, right? They come out of left field. They come from something that doesn't seem to be an industry. And I don't know why it wouldn't happen again. I mean, if I was going to bet, I would say the next big wave would come from the Internet of Things. But, you know, I prepared to be surprised.
Yeah, that's part of the fun of covering this. Do you still have the same relish and excitement covering this, or are you getting changed?
Well, I think this wave of the valley has clearly passed me by. I'm, you know, I'm a geezer. The people who are doing this are in their 20s. I don't understand the cultures. I try to follow the technologies, and the technologies, I mean, the AI stuff is and the fact that it's working. I mean, not strong AI, but weak AI is working big time. pattern recognition mm-hmm. is usable. I wrote about the very first speech recognition technology work done at SRI in the early 1980s, and there was a Office of Naval Research grant that Gary Hendricks had to do you control the ship and you could basically say left and right and it would understand you about half the time. So we've come a long, long way from that. And there's a direct line, going all the way back to Shaky the Robot to, Siri and today's voice recognition technologies.
Well, I, for one, don't want you to give up. You may think you're superannuated, but I think the context that you bring, the understanding, the depth of understanding, the understanding of the history of it is really important to kind of contextualizing what's happening right now. In fact, if there's anything wrong with Silicon Valley today, it's its lack of memory. So whatever you can do to keep reminding us of where we came from, it really helps us understand where we're going. And I am thrilled that I could spend some time with you. Thank you, John.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
John Markoff. Machines of Loving Grace. When's the Stewart Brand book going to come out? Next year?
Oh, God, not quickly.
Yeah.
It's I'm going to take my time.
One of those thick books, I'm sure.
Maybe not, but I'm going to take my time.
Yeah. Yeah. I can't wait to read it. Thank you. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Our show is every Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern, 1900 UTC. A great time to spend some leisurely time talking about what's going on in the world, the tech world around us. I hope you'll tune in every Monday morning. Or afternoon or evening, depending on your time zone. But, you don't have to watch live. You can always get on-demand audio and video after the fact at twit.tv/TRI or subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. I know some of you are listening on airplanes. If you want to know more about all the shows we do, just go to twit.tv. I'm Leo Laporte. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Triangulation.